All right, everybody, welcome after the lunch break. We are here at the Idealo stage. We have another great speaker coming up. It's Carsten Hennig. He is head of international at Mr. Spex. Before joining Mr. Spex, he also worked in investment banking, and he also was a strategy consultant with the Boston Consulting Group in the areas corporate development and growth strategy. Carsten studied at the Goethe University in Frankfurt and at City University of Hong Kong. At Mr. Spex, he is responsible for the international markets. In that case, that is Switzerland, Austria, the UK, the Netherlands, France, and Spain. The topic of this presentation is very interesting. It is, how does a potential path to grow internationally look like for an e-commerce business? A lot of questions. Do you go through market studies? What about the decision to start organically, or do you buy other players? What about the logistics setup? What about localization of customer experience? How do you do tests and iterations towards scaling and building a brand? Very interesting presentation, I think. So put your hands together for Carsten Hennig of Mr. Spex, everybody.
Great. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. I hope you had a great lunch break and know open-minded to talk a little bit about growing into international markets. So our vision at Mr. Spex is to become Europe's favorite way and place to buy eyewear. And therefore, we choose the topic today, talk a little bit about the challenges e-commerce companies are typically facing when they entering new markets next to their initial home market. The topic for today is, I would like to start with a very brief introduction about Mr. Spex, our products, then go forward to the European markets where we are already active in, talk a little bit about their potential, and then the general questions of entering new European markets. And that is, as a company, you will have to decide, first of all, what will be your minimum value proposition to enter a new market, and the general decision whether to build it up organically or to buy some other player. The next is, at least from our perspective, there should be a couple of organizational prerequisites prior to the decision to grow into new regions. And then finally, we talk about the precise path of growth into these countries. Okay, so Mr. Spex is already the largest European online player with more than 2 million customers. We are currently delivering into 11 European countries. We have more than 450 employees, and thereof are more than 80 opticians. The latter part is really important to us, at least. We have a very individualized product and have to take care that our employees overall understand the customer needs, understand the product, and bring both together. We perceive ourselves as data-driven, customer-centric, agile. That basically also from a technical perspective means we do a lot of live A/B testing on our different local websites, learn from them, implement those learnings, and thereby localize the offering. Our value proposition, and we will come to that in more detail later, but overall we try to have always the largest assortment in stock, provide the best value for money. That means we don't want to be a budget provider, but we want to be a premium provider at affordable prices, and that's mainly directed against the offline competition. And overall, buying classes in general is often not fun for a customer, also at an online optician, and we want to improve that buying experience. In a glance, our products are prescription glasses, sunglasses, but also prescription sunglasses, contact lenses. We offer more than 120 brands, some favorite ones like Ray-Ban. Most people probably will have an Ray-Ban sunglasses at home. Premium labels like Tom Ford, Celine, Chloe, independent labels. That's a new growing sector. Usually, it's very difficult to get them at a local optician, and if, then just at a very few across the whole country. And in the meantime, we build it up and produce 5 private labels ourselves. So for example, they're called CO Optical or Michalski for Mr. Specs. Yep. The next is I would like to go over to the, let's say, market analysis for the European optician market. And that's what every e-commerce should do before going international. So if you compare, let's say, the online optician market with the consumer electronics book markets or the typical Amazon fields, we would call them a very major market with a share of 20-30%. If you go down to the age range of, let's say, 20 to 50, that would almost double. On the other hand, prescription glasses market is still very small online. But on the other hand, it's very lucrative. It's huge, has more than 30 billion euro in revenues across Europe, has a very high EBITDA margin, and the online share varies between country, between 3-7% only. So for an online optician, there's a lot of space to grow. So to show you where we are present today and how it evolved, Mr. Specs was actually founded 2007 and gone live in 2008 in Germany. And then we built up other countries organically around Germany. And then we decided we want to grow even faster by acquiring existing players, and that basically applied to the Nordics, so Norway, Sweden, Finland. Let's have a look to them in a little bit more detail. So in Scandinavia, we've seen that there are already a couple of competitors in the market with a very strong positioning. They are, have been mainly contact lens players. And we decided to overtake Lensdo and Lof Eyewear in Sweden and Finland and Lensit in Norway. And initially, they have been really niche players, purely contact lens providers. And you have to say that in the Nordics, the contact lens share between all eyewear wearer is significant higher than, for example, in Germany. They would be like roughly 20% against 5-7% here in Germany. And after the acquisition, it's basically a two-step approach to finally take out the synergies you could pull out, and that is first-hand do an IT migration, starting with the ERP system in order to become able to provide your full assortment of products. So to those formerly only contact lens customers, which obviously need eyewear, you're now in a position to provide them also prescription glasses and prescription sunglasses. And then in the next step, it's rebranding, because the overall strategy of Mr. Specs is finally to appear as one brand across Europe. But to do that, it's actually a stepwise approach, because you have to imagine contact lenses almost as kind of an a frequent moving consumer good, because the repurchasing cycle is extremely low compared to prescription glasses. So people might buy 4 times, 5 times a year contact lenses, but only every couple of years a new pair of glasses. And therefore, roughly 70-80% of all your customers will be existing customers coming back. And if you make it too clear cut in your brand perception, you're going to risk losing customers. And therefore, we did it in a very stepwise way, which took finally over a year, but ensured that customers get step by step by step a little bit more accustomed to the new brand, Mr. Specs. If we have a look to all our international markets and try to score them a little bit, it's obviously always the question in general about the level of online affinity. So in general, we perceive Northern European countries already deeper in the share of buying products online, whereas like everything Southern Europe is a little bit, in a more development stage. So the percentage of people buying online is there a little bit lower yet. Then another question is the price level in that country compared to your actual cost position. So if you start a new country, and let's say you build it up organically, the country in the beginning won't be large enough to scale up an own local warehouse. So you will have to deliver from your main hub. In our case, that's Berlin. And that means you have to consider the shipping cost two ways, especially if people in the beginning only try and then return completely. And if that fits against the local market pricing, it's great. If not, be careful. And you should always consider market entry barriers. In our case, this is mainly customs, and that applies to Switzerland and also to Norway. And that's can be a quite complicated topic. We will come later to it, but we offer something which is called a home trial. So people can order up to 4 frames to their homes to test them, get a feeling, touch them before deciding, okay, I want that and that pair. And get it placed. So basically, you're delivering a large amount of volume into a country and might have to pay import VAT tax and then have to see to get it back in case of returns. But also, second topic is regulation. And here in our case, it's again two major topics. One hand is the question whether people can simply go to a local optician and make an eye test there, or if they still have to go to an eye doctor to make that examination. And just to give you a few figures, in Germany, like 20 years ago, over 90% of the people still went to an eye doctor, whereas today, over 90% only go to a local optician. So it shifted completely. In some other countries, it's still by regulation required to visit an eye doctor, and it makes it a little bit more difficult for you to acquiring new customers in the beginning. A second topic is the insurance coverage and reimbursement. So in Germany, most people won't, at least those who are state insured, won't get any reimbursement back. Those who have private insurance might get back a few hundred euros every few years. In other countries, that's much more complicated. So for example, in France, it's a three-stage insurance scheme, starting basically with a very small state insurance, then a major one, which covers probably half of the expense and is paid by the employer, and then the third one paid by the individual itself, who covers the rest. And that's kind of difficult to address to. Okay, let's now talk about the steps of entering into a new market. From our perception, you should always have in place a great e-commerce customer experience as a minimum value proposition for a young market to enter into. In our case, we mentioned it already, it's the large assortment. Then it comes to a couple of technology features on the website. So one is a smart filter function. So in order to navigate across some 10,000 different products for prescription and sunglasses, you will need these kind of filter to find the perfect one for you. And if you found something you're interested in, there's also technology-driven recommendation engine, which provides additional other frames being similar or could fit you if you like the other one. Then extremely fun for most of our customers is a virtual try-on tool. You can use that on each laptop or mobile device and then see for the pair of glasses how it would fit your face, and you could even move around and the glass will move with you. So you get a very good practical impression how that would fit. If customers are still undecided at this point of the journey, they can do these free home trial, ordering up to 4 frames at their home and test it for 10 days. That's also something like most of our customers, if they go to an offline optician, feel a little bit pressured having to do a decision within just a few minutes and then having those pair of glasses for the next couple of years. And this home trial relaxes this process quite a lot. We always use a couple of high-tech materials. We perceive it almost as kind of an airbag which should fit into each pair of glasses, but a lot of competitors still charge for that extra, and that's basically a scratch-resistant, super anti-reflective, and UV filter system. Our standard lenses are always for free, and they fit, let's say, 50 to 60% of all our customers, and thereby people can usually save easily 50% compared to an offline optician. And that is because the optician industry, the local optician industry, has absurd high margins, and we use a little bit of scaling and give back the customer part of that too high margins out in the market. We do have a quite transparent pricing. If the customer wants to have an upgrade on the lenses, that's usually also a little bit, let's say, hidden. Also a minimum is to provide a customer service, and with customer service here, I mean like a phone hotline, a free phone hotline in English. The next development stage is, we call it multi-channel or best of two worlds, is actually the combination of online and offline. So that includes, of course, in customer service in local language. We, in the meantime, rolled that out for all of our countries. So in all 11 countries, we have local language service support. The next thing is in cooperation with local opticians. So basically, we are approaching local opticians in a usually B-plus area in the city. So those opticians will have, well, usually half their day, nothing to do. And we send them, our customers, online to offline in order to provide services like an eye test or a frame fitting after they made a purchase. And we compensate those partner opticians with a fixed fee for these services, but also with part of the revenue share if it leads up to a follow-up order. We have rolled out that already for Austria, Switzerland, Netherlands. The next will be Sweden, actually, in a couple of weeks, where we start brand new with this partner optician program. And in Germany, where it is most rolled out, that includes some 650 partner optician already. The last step, actually, are our own stores. So Mr. Specs now operates 6 stores in Germany. There are a couple more coming this year. And why are we doing that? We still believe in being an online optician, but there's a certain level of customer that that needs a first offline touch point, like these stores. And we come a little bit later to the conception of those stores, but basically over 50% of our customers there make their next purchase online, so it perfectly fits in our overall strategy, becoming the number one online provider in Europe. Besides in countries where we already play TV spots for a couple of years, you build it up in the past, a strong brand, and you can really leverage on that with the stores. And you can also send your online customers to the stores and thereby leverage the traffic. Next question is the general decision whether to build and buy, and we covered that already partially, therefore I will go quite quick over this. The main decision to start organically is that you have an attractive market with a very limited competition. Obviously, there is no one you can overtake. And it should not be a problem if you deliver from your main operational hub. Whereas if you go into a market where there is already strong competition, it makes usually more sense to overtake someone, especially if it brings also strategic assets. In our case, that would be, for example, a local warehouse. And the question whether you can generate synergies, which is usually given if you, for example, just take over a contact lens trader and then improve to the full assortment. The next few mandatory prerequisites before actually expanding international, we decided for ourselves that it's quite interesting to source in the value chain in the optician industry. So basically, there are, let's say, raw lenses produced by just a few multi-corporate provider in the world, and the main part of the value chain is then etching those raw lenses for the individual customer needs and the individual frame the customer has decided to buy. And we do this glazing for single vision, very focal prescription sunglasses for over 60% of our lenses ourselves in a large workshop which we have built up here in Berlin, in Siemensstadt. And for that, going forward, the best is to even leverage it even more. And that means like growing even into more European countries to leverage this workshop. A second thing is also like for your general assortment, you will have to need one central hub for a region. A region would be Europe. For the long tail products, and then use the local warehouse for the fast moving products. Also on the IT and tech side, a few recommendations if you're gonna internationalize your e-commerce business. First is use one ERP system. It should be possible to program that with your own developers. It should cover different sales channels. In our case, that's basically different domains. It should allow that you can activate, deactivate your assortment from country to country and specialize over there. Obviously, you need different pricing, different currencies. You will need to handle different shipment provider, so you have a different shipment labeling on the packages itself. You will have very different payment provider from market to market. And from the front-end web shop system, ideally you will choose a system, whether self-developed or purchased, that allows you to develop at the same point of time for desktop and mobile, for online and offline, if you later on decide that you want to go this multi-channel way. It should allow that additional futures program for this front end can be directly activated or deactivated from country to country, because that's what you need to individualize your customer experience. And another recommendation is to use as many keys as possible. The last part is how to actually enter into the market. So we covered most of that already. The first is get ready to play. Translate your website, get all operational needs in place to really deliver to the customer in that country, have the payment methods, and track that by simply have no customer complaints, no bugs. Second part, product market fit is optimizing your local conversion rate. If the local conversion rate on site, on organic traffic is not high enough, your service does not yet fit the local market. You have to figure out why and then optimize and localize your site. The next part is online marketing and online marketing scaling. So basically that covers all kind of, I would call it pull channels, like SEO, ZR, wherever people type in a search engine something and thereby indicating that right now they are ready to buy your product. And the last step then is to find and leverage push channels. And push channels is where you really build a brand, and that could be like TV, that could be out of home advertisement, that could be even like a huge Facebook campaign or similar. For the marketing deep dive, I think we're running a little bit out of time. Maybe one thing before you finally get ready to do a big time branding campaign. They are usually extremely expensive. You usually need a high budget to really come in a position where your media pressure in that level is high enough. So just a quick example, if you go for TV, you usually need 5 to 6 touch points. So every potential customer have to see you in TV at least 5 or 6 times to really remind you. And that means like a high enough pressure. And if you don't invest enough into such a push channel in the very beginning, it won't work out. Our recommendation is use as many visuals, wordings, test, optimize before you do that. So we, for example, we even produce our TV spots in-house ourselves. And we usually test at least 20 different versions against each other before we finally decide with which one we go to the media stations, because then it's a multi-million investment. So in general, to prepare for these large branding campaigns, one very important topic is the first-hand conversion rate. So basically, if you generate just traffic that does not convert, you're burning money, obviously. In order to increase the conversion rate, you have to go from country to country individually and see, okay, what are the issues, and then you will come up with many, many small steps to optimize. Our recommendation is focus first on the big ones. And just to give a little instructions, what a few of those big ones could be. So that's a standardized IT platform, which allows you an easy rollout of technical features to all countries. It's a so-called front-end personalization software, which allows you on top of your website simply test and create these localization feelings for the customer. It's very important, the CRM, customer relationship management, segmentation, automation. That means like a tool who goes through your existing customer base, segments them, says, okay, in which cycle and with which content I have to touch those existing customers again and then send it out completely automated. That's very important because usually you overpay a little bit to acquire new customers. And if you won't come in a position to monetize your existing customer base, it won't work off. Very strong thing is word of mouth. So we, in panel journeys, we discovered that this is actually the second biggest new customer acquisition channel after TV, but even before Google, organic search, or AdWords. And it will work to a certain extent simply by itself without doing anything, but you could double or triple the impact by having a good friend referral program, a technical program. Okay. That's just two graphs from what I'm talking when I mean you build up a brand. A brand means like for example, TV investment. You will have an increasing brand awareness, and finally, that increasing brand awareness will create the trust customer needs to buy on your web shop, and thereby you will even further kick your conversion rate. Very important topic. The very last slide to show you is when finally you come into the position of multi-channel and developing own stores. That's, for example, like our stores look like. They're very open spaced. They have in here these different laptops, so customers come in, make an eye test, test, let's say, the first frames, whether they like them or not, then directly creating an online account. In that online account, store the eye data for that customer, store the most preferable frames they like, and then later on at home, they can decide which one they really want to order, maybe use the recommendation engine, see a few other frames which you usually can't have in the store. So that's it. It was a pleasure to be here today.